Will quantum computers break Bitcoin? We live in a world of certain uncertainty and quantum probability. Whether or not you're dealt a 15 or a 20 at the blackjack table, or which direction the stock market goes, may very well be determined intrinsically at the quantum level. Even after centuries of advancement, we still struggle with calculating uncertainties and probability accurately, which is sometimes why we make bad decisions and accidents still happen. But what if we've been approaching this problem of uncertainty the wrong way? What if there was a way to use the quantum world where things can exist and not exist at the same time? Parallel worlds become possible and particles at great distances can affect each other instantaneously, irrespective of distance. Could we use uncertainty at the quantum level to transform our computational and analytical methods to usher in the next great technological revolution? Is there a chance for quantum computers to redefine how humanity solves its problems? Would this create some more problems than it solves? Stay tuned where we discuss the topics of what a quantum computer is and what its implications might be to mankind, cryptography, and of course, Bitcoin. Hi, I'm Mike from the Quantum Resistant Ledger, where we design the only purpose-built open-source blockchain and cryptocurrency that's NIST draft recommended and quantum resistant. Today we're going to dive deep into the world of quantum computers, so prepare to have mind equals blown. Look at the index below to jump to specific topics or just skip to the end for quantum computers explained to grandma in bullet points below. While this video is about quantum computers, some quick history will help with context. Man has tried for centuries to understand the world in which we live. From looking up and writing stories about the pictures that they saw in the stars to harnessing the atom for nuclear energy, quantum computers like Mother Nature may very well be the next technological revolution powered by the fundamental properties of Mother Nature. Abstractly, the idea of quantum computing has existed for decades since Alan Turing started exploring the question of whether or not machines can think when the Turing machine was first proposed in 1936. Fast forward through classical computers to the 1980s when a quantum mechanical Turing machine, which is a primitive computer, was first proposed by Paul Benioff in the 1980s. Discussion at this time existed around how Mother Nature could be used to solve mankind's problems, but no one really knew if a quantum computer could work until 1998 when the first primitive quantum computer performed its first calculation. Growing up, I was taught in school how the nucleus lies at the center of the atom and an electron revolves around the nucleus at specific energy levels, which of course gave us great insight and the show Quantum Leap. However, we no longer think of electrons in this way. Like light, electrons behave as if they are both a particle and a wave. Now, this is very strange to think of. For example, if we were to equate a particle to that of a baseball, the analogy is easy to understand. But how can a particle behave like a wave? When referring to a wave, we're actually talking about a wave function, which is a mathematical representation of probability, not a physical wave like you'd see at the beach, even though that it does share some of the same characteristics. If you were able to touch it, the object would instantly turn into a particle at the moment you measured it, saw it, touched it, whatever. Recently, experiments have shown that this state of superposition can apply to entire atoms as well, raising very interesting questions as to what is real and what is not. Was likely the inspiration for the phrase, if a branch falls in the forest, does it make a sound? Scientists are still trying to get to the root of exactly what reality is, which is where the quantum world of mathematical probability ends and the macroscopic world that we see and touch starts. The point is, uncertainty is a fundamental part of what makes up us and our lives. Enter the quantum computer. So what is so interesting about quantum computing? Quantum computers work in terms of probability. This means that it gives probabilistic answers. In computer class, you might have learned about binary code using bits. It uses either a 0 or a 1 in order to process information. However, a quantum computer uses a probabilistic approach by using qubits, which can have, for example, all combinations of 00, 01, 10, and 11, all at the same time. From another angle, let's use an example. I know that at 9 o'clock in the morning, you can be either at home or at work. There can be a dozen other possibilities. Their chance to be true is less likely. Unless I give you a call or visit you at your place or office, I cannot know which location you're at. For me, you are in a state of superposition or probability. This is what makes quantum computers so powerful, is their exponential, or sometimes referred to as even doubly exponential, nature. Each qubit doubles its relative computing power. Relative to classical computing, 8 bits equals 1 byte, but in quantum computing, 8 bits equals 64 bytes. With many high-quality qubits, the right environmental conditions, and an algorithm, we can perform calculations faster than any modern classical supercomputer. It can be a little unsettling to think of that the world around us existing in a state of probability with no materialistic properties until it's observed. In the case of quantum entanglement, where you have two particles born of the same event, once observed, it instantly heralds its twin into existence, no matter how much distance is separated between the two. Despite being counterintuitive to how we observe reality, experiment after experiment has shown this to be true. Fast forward to 2020. Big data is gold, and he who controls it is king. Across sectors, biology, technology, social networking, pharmaceuticals, financial, it's apparent that there are incredible opportunities available to those who can build and successfully deploy systems to calculate data. Not only do we need things to be processed faster, we need them to be able to store more information. This is where quantum computing shows a great promising future and exactly what all of the hype is about. Okay, so you might be asking, if these machines are so amazing, why haven't we shifted to them already? Quantum computing is a relatively new field still in its infancy. The technology bears no resemblance in function or appearance to a computer you have used before. It doesn't use transistors or logic gates like your smartphone or your PC like one would expect. Quantum computers are analog in nature, so the output of them is probabilistic. Now that we've already begun talking about the challenges and complexities in quantum computing, let's talk about what a quantum computer is. Most mainstream designs around quantum computers have a few requirements. First off, number one, it needs qubits, the quantum equivalent of a bit that can be put into superposition. These can be anything from matter and ions to even potentially photons of light. The qubits need to be able to interact with each other. That's number two. Number three, qubits need to be able to hold information, and this information must be able to be retrieved. Number four, the qubits need to be stable long enough to perform some sort of calculation. And number five, in most cases, all of this must be done near absolute zero within special refrigerators called dilution refrigerators. These refrigerators are capable of producing the coldest temperatures in the known universe, which has been one of the greatest thermodynamic challenges during construction of these machines. There's also a type of quantum computer that uses photons as qubits that started to grow and show progress over the past few years that can be operated at room temperature, which is really exciting. The ability to perform calculations simultaneously at each qubit is both its superpower and Achilles heel. On one hand, qubits are very powerful, but on the other hand, they're very sensitive to any type of electromagnetic disturbance or any other type of disturbance. However, despite all the challenges and complexities, the possibility of quantum computers being able to process and make sense of big data in the future would be game-changing and are simply too massive or lucrative to ignore. With the recent wave of AI, blockchain, and other innovations, big data has become more important every passing year. All artificial algorithms rely on the data for which they are input, and the greater the data, the greater the accuracy of the AI. However, the greater of the data, the more difficult it is to compute, and standard CPUs and GPUs just simply don't have the processing power to do this. We would have to extract data in batches and then train the AI model to distribute the load, and this can be so time consuming that it just becomes not worth it. But what if we don't have to wait for days to train a model? What if our AI models can be trained in a matter of hours or minutes? Quantum computers have the potential to work together harmoniously with classical computers to solve new types of problems. So what does this mean for cryptography, encryption, cryptocurrencies? Where do quantum computers come in? This will all be covered in a later chapter, but if you're always the one to read ahead in class, this is performed by an algorithm called Shor's algorithm, which performs something called factorization. All right, let's distill all of this into quantum computers explained to grandma in bullet points. Here we go. Everything a normal or classical computer does comes from a zero or a one. This includes phone calls, Facebook, photos, messaging, everything. All of it's made up of zeros and ones with an electrical signal made from light. In a quantum computer, the zero and ones are more like a spinning quarter or dime, both a zero and a one at the same time. This is the greatest advantage that quantum computers have over normal computers because they use a completely different set of rules to operate. A quantum computer and a computer such as the one in your house are more different than they are alike. Quantum computers are still very, very new and are commercially available by two companies so far, IBM and D-Wave. However, governments and corporations all around the world are scrambling to build the most powerful machines at great costs. Quantum computers have the potential to be much, much faster at solving problems in areas like cryptography, engineering, pharmaceuticals, and finances. They are great at finding solutions to come up with some of the problems that normal computers struggle with, but are not good for everything. Quantum computers will likely never replace normal computers. They need to work together as a team. Society is still trying to understand all of the things that these machines can do, and there are still existing engineering challenges that need to be overcome. Not all of the bugs are worked out so far, so normal computers are still the best option for 99% of tasks. Progress in the field of quantum computers is increasing very, very quickly, week by week. Announcements by companies like IBM, IonQ, D-Wave, and Honeywell seem to indicate the coming of a completely new generation of computers, nothing like the ones we have today. The quantum threat has been known about for more than 25 years. In 2015, researchers estimated that it would take a billion qubits to crack RSA 2048. Later on, this in 2019, this number was reduced to 20 million. The latest estimates now put the number of qubits between 2300 and 2600 that for qubits that are error corrected. As of October 1st, 2020, quantum startup IonQ claims a quantum volume of an incredible 4 million. Now, while this claim still needs to be substantiated, companies are getting more and more confident with their claims and in some cases putting their reputations on the line. Research is still being done on what level of quantum volume starts to threaten Bitcoin and other areas of cryptography. So, the question you should be asking yourself is, given the obvious and tremendous advancements being made, at what point does not holding QRL become too great of a risk? Stay tuned for our next episode where we continue down the path of how quantum computers and blockchain on intercept course. Until then, thanks for watching.